Hi, my name is Andrew Eiche, and this is my talk titled Subtitles in XR, a Practical Framework. I am the COOwl and Cable Slinger at Owlchemy Labs. I am also the co-chair of the XRA Accessibility Working Group. Owlchemy Labs is a VR video game studio based out of Austin, Texas. We developed games such as Rick and Morty Virtual Reality, Job Simulator, and most recently Vacation Simulator. And Owlchemy cares because our vision statement is VR is for everyone, and accessibility is key to that vision. So we strive to be a leader in accessibility in VR and, by proxy, XR. Subtitles are particularly hard and have always been kind of a stretch goal for us. We hadn't yet developed a system until most recently on Vacation Simulator, so we invested specific time and effort, a good chunk of it, to creating this. And we believe that our system is the basis for what XR subtitles could be going forward. We call it Guided Level Organic Safe Subtitles, or GLOSS for short. So let me show you a brief video of what GLOSS looks like in action.
Now for the fun part. Let's take a peek inside your suite. To move around, look where you want to go. Then hold this button until you see your destination.
Hello, human. Grab a cartridge from the tray and let's get to work. Are you a fan of slushies and hot dogs?
That's pretty good overview of kind of what's going on with the system. So let's break it down and show you how we created it and how you can take our learning and bring it to your content. So we'll get started with the fundamentals. Some key definitions to begin. Two main terms. One is subtitles, the other is closed captions. This is the way that we define them. Not everybody defines them this way, but I want to create the standard so that we can understand what we're talking about. So in our case, subtitles are specifically a spoken word taken into text format and relatively synced up with that. Closed captions are a textual representation of audio that could be a complete audio replacement. You can get a sense of all the content just from the captions. Now, just to show you what this looks like kind of as a set, right? If this is all the audio, closed captions are going to be a subset of that, but a pretty large subset, right? You're not going to do all the audio, but just the audio you need to understand the content. And then subtitles that we're referring to are kind of a subset in tied closed captions. So not all the audio, but the voiceover. So here's our primary requirement when developing a subtitle system. We want to display a highly accurate, legible text representation of voiceover. This is key. If we don't do this, then nothing else matters, right? We also have some additional requirements that are important for our system and specifically the medium we're working in, such as the reader being able to understand who is speaking, being able to locate the source of the audio in space, so where it's coming from. Synchronization between the text and the audio is really important too. So that way, you know, context clues, especially since we do humorous content, timing is very important. And text should be comfortable. That's not an optional thing. Comfort isn't optional, especially in VR, but in general, comfort shouldn't be optional in user experience. So we already have subtitles already exist. They exist in flat content. So what can we use and where do we have to deviate? So some of the similarities of things that we can grab from flat content is the syntax, right? There's a familiar italicized, bolding, dashes, all these things that have been developed for years. We can just reuse those in our content. Legibility over a highly dynamic background. So, you know, the background's going to be moving, it's going to be light, it's going to be dark, it could be a number of things. We want to make sure that it remains legible regardless of what the background is. And that groundwork has already been laid in video. Syncing with audio in a readable way. We can't put the whole script up on the screen, right? We can't put an individual word up on the screen at a time. We have to kind of find some middle ground there to not lose the folks who are enjoying the content. They want to be able to understand what's happening and not just be spending the whole time reading. Places where we have to diverge because of our medium, we don't have a singular focal point, right? So in 2D content, you know you have a screen somewhere, and we know that the screen can fit within the entire field of view of the viewer's vision, or at least some large subset. Therefore, we don't have to worry about the viewer looking anywhere except for at the screen, so we can use that to our advantage. We don't have that advantage in spatial content. We want our users to be looking all around. We want our players to be experiencing the world. We also need to be able to locate the source of the sound. Again, this is spatial content, right? We want to guide players with audio to locations, and we need our subtitles to do the same. And 2D content rarely induces motion sickness. Yes, there are cases of it, but VR is very easy to induce motion sickness, and for an accessibility feature, that's very off-putting. So we have to make sure whatever we develop does not increase propensity for motion sickness. And don't reinvent the wheel here, right? So the things that we're going to take from existing published standards. So Netflix and the BBC have great published standards. We use Netflix a lot. Very simple stuff to read. You should absolutely use what they have when it makes sense. But again, don't be afraid to take your own path when it also makes sense for the content. So the kind of core of everything is going to be this box that the subtitles live in our gloss system. So we need to start from the box and build out from there. So you can see a picture of the box on the right is what we're talking about. And so one of the key features is contrast, right? We use transparency to mask out content. So, you know, the box is, you know, very dark, as you can see, but we don't want to completely occlude the contents from, you know, what you're looking at as a player, right? So we use transparency, not complete occlusion. And then we have high contrast letters on top of the dark box for easy visibility, and the high contrast outline too, right? You can see it in space. Length of duration, again, we talked about this before. We use Netflix, right? 42 characters per line, 2 lines per subtitle, and 1 to 7 seconds per subtitle. We just grabbed right from their spec. As far as identifying the source of the audio, in XR we have to identify the source of the audio because we don't have the luxury of the frame being cut right on, hard cut right on somebody's face. We don't have, you know, that kind of back and forth. So we have to kind of do a bunch of things to tell our players who is speaking, what is speaking, what is generating that audio. In our case, we use icons. Icons are a great visual way of representing it because you don't need to remember all the characters' names in your head. And then a point of note is we specifically drew these icons, so they are created to look really good at small format. It's not just a screenshot of the audio source. And here is the box in action, so you can see that.
As
you can see, you know,
why am I even in a hot tub?
That box, you can see that it relates directly to the character that's speaking, and the background has some darks and some lights, and it's really working well across that. So now let's get into spatialization, right? We have the box, and it's great, but it doesn't solve all our requirements. We need to make sure that it's comfortable to read, and the reader should be able to locate the source of the audio. So just having a box and space is not going to accomplish that task. We're going to have to figure out where to place it, how to place it, as well as what's comfortable for the player. And the spatial nature is the key element. Again, I'm going to keep hammering on this point. The spatial nature is the key element of VR. That's what we're trying to really make sure translates through our subtitles. So we must design subtitles that are not going to detract from the spatialization, the depth experience of that. We want to make sure that they at least meet it, if not enhance the experience. So let's talk about some existing solutions and kind of walk through some of the prior art that people have done as they've created things. I'm going to just kind of go through these pretty quick. They should be fairly self-explanatory. So we're going to talk about headlock here, right? So as you can see, headlock is the content is in a fixed position as you move your head, right? No matter where you move your head, it sticks to your vision. So, you know, definitely something that's attached to the head. And the area where we receive trouble is there's convergence issues, right? When it's stuck to your face, your eyes go cross-eyed, you have eye strain because you have to keep looking down even though your head's pointed a different direction, because it doesn't matter where you tilt your head, the subtitles are always going to be at the same spot. And there's lots and lots of UX reasons. You can watch a million talks on VR that say, don't stick things to the player's face. Don't stick things to the player's face. That's a bad idea, right? Don't parent the text to the face. That is not subtitles. That is a painful experience. And we can't locate the audio source, right? It doesn't even solve that. So it's just stuck to your face. It hurts. It sucks. Our next one is the fixed Y position, or halo, as I call it, right? This is where the subtitle itself stays in one spot. And then as you turn your head left and right, you know, on the horizontal, it sticks with you. But as you turn it vertical, the subtitle stays in the same spot. And what we get there is a lot of the same issues as headlock. You know, it's still in a specific position. At least now we can position it in our vision. But the problem with that is we can actually lose the subtitle, right? If you tilt your head too far down, the subtitle's gone. So now you have to expend conscious effort thinking about where the subtitle is and how to read it. And that's not good. And again, you can't locate the audio source, right? You're still, they're still kind of on your head. The next one that a lot of people jump to is head follow. So you can see it's got like this little whirly bird thing, and it's the subtitles are independent of the head, but they try their best to follow where your gaze is, right? And a good implementation of this really allows for players to, you know, for the developer to play with how this moves in and out, right? So you can have some fun with it, and you can really make it great. But, you know, and it feels like part of the world, which is fantastic. Downside, you know, or upside, I mean, it's less likely to induce motion sickness. So this is also a great feature of it, but can't locate the audio source. So, and then fixed position being our next one. So this is, we stick something specifically in space, and then you look left, you look right, right? It stays in the same position no matter where you are in 3D space. And if we use that position as the source of the audio, now we can locate the audio. This is fantastic. It's really strong ties to the world. Love it. You know, we know, hey, this thing happens at this space in the world, but now you have to figure out where the subtitle position is, and you have to keep focused on it, right? You have to keep looking for the subtitle and then keep focusing on that subtitle. So, and if you put it on the player like a watch or something, it can be fatiguing to pull that up and down, and then that loses the position. So that's kind of the ones that we see generally developed, and that was our starting point, right? Take all those and figure out where we can best chart a course. So, you know, our system gloss, what did we do, right? We took our subtitle box we previously covered, and then we took head follow and fixed position and kind of bashed them together and built on top of that to create that final design. So some of the basics of it, right? We have these small indicators that point back to the audio source. You've seen them before, though, that little arrow. We always put the text on top. The box always stays completely on top if it can. We don't want a content occluding it. That would be bad for readability. But that does create some problems with potential motion sickness and some other things. So we have a few tricks in our pocket, transparency, seeing through it being one. But some other tricks we'll talk about later that help kind of push that off. We generally have content as constants. We generally keep the content at a constant size. So regardless of whether you're leaning in or out, we want the content to remain at one size. That's really important for readability. Now, I only say generally because there's a trick we'll talk about that we do that changes it ever so subtly just for, again, that depth perception trick. And we keep it level with the horizon, ignoring player head tilt. This keeps it grounded in the world. So, you know, let's go ahead and see an example of that now. And as you can see, it keeps it grounded in the world to have that head tilt. You can see the player tilting their head and you understand where it is. Just like you're laying on a couch, you wouldn't expect the subtitles to switch. And this one, you can see the arrow guiding the player back. So that little subtle arrow moving the player back. So the next thing we have to do is figure out, you know, where to place this. So we're going to talk about the subtitle safe box. So that's a bounding box with a position where subtitles can be safe. So kind of vision theory here, right? You have a certain area of your vision that you can highly focus in, and then even a smaller chunk that you can really highly focus in. So the subtitles have to remain in that spot to be legible. This is kind of an example. This isn't precise, but, you know, as a diagram, you can see it's a small chunk of the rendered screen. And those are valid subtitle positions. Subtitles cannot come to rest outside those. So we have two states now. One is called speaker fully visible. This is the source of the sound is on the screen with enough space left in the subtitle safe box to fit the subtitle above it, right? So we have, if it's me, we have enough space above me to fit the subtitle safe box above my head, right? If I move anywhere else, then that's not that state. And so that state's called speaker not fully visible, right? And that's any other state, right? Anything outside of that, I can fit the content and the above the source is speaker visible. Everything else, speaker not fully visible. And so in speaker fully visible state, what we do is we put the subtitle over the source of the audio like a speech bubble. And we took inspiration from comic books because they had a really great language for relating speech to a spatialized piece of content, right? Because you could have two characters speaking. You can have all these fantastic things happening in a comic book. And then speaker not fully visible, the subtitle stays within the safe zone. We use that indicator, which you can see here, to point back to the audio source. And the indicator should stay along the edge of that little box, right? Of the where it says, hello, human, right? We don't move that off of there. So that gently guides you back. And then when you move your head, right, so kind of those were two static spots. When you move your head, the box snaps to the source when it becomes fully visible, and then it snaps off the source and tries to follow you when it falls into that other state, that not fully visible. There's a little bit of light damping, so you can turn your head faster than the subtitle, but it's very, very light. We found that that's all you need to make it feel independent, and we do the best attempt at keeping it within the safe zone as you're turning your head, so that way you can read as you're, like, moving around and looking around. Our heads move a lot. You find that out as you do VR. So here is some of the positioning and movement and a video of all of that. So you can see here, we turn and we fell out of that safe zone and now the subtitle popped off. And here we swing and you can see the subtitle try to catch up. So that's kind of the movement. And you can even see the arrow now pointing on the on your screen, pointing back to where the player's shortest head turn can be to get back to the source of the audio. And then these are a few of those other design choices I mentioned earlier. So we use this subtle zoom in and out effect. So that is the changing of the size. It's very subtle and it's almost too hard to demonstrate. But, you know, as you move in, the content lightly zooms in. And as you move out, it lightly zooms out. And then it kind of pops back. And it's just a subtle effect to help with motion sickness and help understand the depth of it. We also, on a per platform basis, when available, use the depth shader to show when objects would be in front of the subtitle or behind the subtitle. Here you can see a picture of that. So that blue outline actually is indicating to the player that the subtitle is either intersecting or behind that television. In VR, it's very clear what's happening and it's a really neat effect. It's a complicated effect to program, but it was totally worth it. With some, you know, kind of crazy shader math. But, you know, if it's available and you could do it, it really adds to understanding the depth of the subtitle in space without any of those convergence issues. Sometimes we just use 2D subtitles, right? You know, who cares? We use the 2D subtitles if it makes sense. It's a best practice. So in the case of the TV, people are already used to interacting with TVs and 2D subtitles, so why have this whole extra box when you can just put the subtitle on the screen? And our spectator camera also uses 2D subtitles because our expectation is that those people watching a spectator camera are doing so on a flat screen, and so we can use all the assumptions of traditional subtitles. So kind of coming to our end here, looking towards the future of gloss and kind of where we're going with this, we want you to steal our gloss, please. Our specific implementation that we made of this, of gloss, is deeply rooted in our systems, but the design is straightforward enough to implement in your own content. So, you know, you could take exactly what I said here, re-implement it. We'd love to see it. And we want you to make our gloss shine, right? There's still lots of room for improvement. So just a few examples, right? Closed captions, right? We laid that out in the beginning and then we said, we're not doing it. So this is an example of what a closed caption could look like, but there's lots of issues. There's lots of sounds going on. What is a priority? What takes priority in interactive content? That's all very complicated, even in flat content. And then when you get to 3D spatialized content, it gets really difficult. Also multiplayer, right? We're a single player company, so we don't, we haven't really done a lot of work in multiplayer. So, you know, is this good for text chat? Like, will it work for that? Will this work for auto captioning, right? Will this work for conferences? We just don't know. So it's something we'd love to see explored. And I can't wait to see what you all do with this after seeing this. So that's kind of the talk. If you want to follow me, all my things are Budding Monkey. You can follow Owlchemy Labs at Owlchemy Labs, Twitter, Facebook, Insta, TikTok. We got it all. And you can head to our website if you want to hear more about what we're doing at alchemylabs.com. Thank you so much.